Okay, in this video, we're going to look at Dolly 2, the model recently released by Databricks, which is a version 2 of Dolly that they released probably only 2 weeks ago. So this model is, they've got a nice blog post going through not only what they've done, but also their thinking behind what they've done. And I think that this really outlines some nice things that they point out that sort of like the most common question that they got with Dolly 1. And this is true that of all the llama models or all the models that are based on the base model llama model is people are asking, can we use this commercially? I'm also seeing a lot of comments like that for videos that I've made. And they point out that the answer is probably not in here. So their goal with Dolly 2 was to make something that was totally can be used by research and can be used for commercial use. So the main sort of the key change that they've made in here is they've swapped out llama for the 12 billion parameter Luther AI's Pythia model. And actually, this is a family of models. So they've trained up a few different sizes, which I'll show you later on. They've also, so that's one step forward. So suddenly now they're no longer using the llama model. Now, is the Pythia model as good as the llama model? Probably not. But it turns out that if you do a lot of fine tuning on it, you can probably get a really good result from what they show. The second part was where all the alpaca models and a lot of the share GPT kind of models were based on distillation outputs of ChatGPT or GPT-3. They've realized that's not really legit for commercial use. So they've gone and made their own data set. And I think this is one of the biggest contributions that they've made with Dolly 2 is actually this data set. Because this data set is a lot of work. As they point out, I think in the blog post somewhere, that it turns out to be a lot more work than you think for making something like this. So that the data set is 15,000 of these instruct kind of tasks. So similar to what ChatGPT would do, but not using anything from ChatGPT. And they made use of 5,000 employees at Databricks. So that's pretty cool, right? I guess if you've got 15,000, you only need each person to do three of them. They do point out later on, though, that they actually had to turn this into a competition. Or is it somewhere up here that they turned it into a competition for this to basically get people to do quite a lot of them. So as I pointed out earlier, they point out why did they create the new data set? The number one reason being that people were asking, can I use this commercially? And the answer was probably not. And they looked around for like, okay, well, what data sets could we use? And I think they've actually made some really interesting choices here. So the OpenAI had a paper, one of the first early papers about this fine tuning and RLHF was the InstructGPT paper. And in that, they had a data set of 13,000 demonstrations. So the idea here is that they were going for more than that, but roughly in the same ballpark of that. And as they point out, turns out generating 13,000 questions is a lot harder than it looks. Every answer needs to be original. You can't just copy something from the web. These are the kind of things that they were faced with. And the other thing that I think is a really interesting point that they make here is that the OpenAI data set was actually made with 40 labelers. 40 people doing the actual data set. Whereas the Databricks one has 5,000 people. It's probably not 5,000 in total, but it's certainly a lot more than 40, right? We're talking about thousands of people here. And the interesting thing with that is we're probably going to get a more sort of sense of diversity in the actual data set. So I know one of the things that OpenAI has been looking at is how do they source their labelers? And can they get laborers from different countries and different backgrounds? And, you know, they want diversity in this kind of thing. And in many ways, Databricks has done that just by going for a whole lot of people in their employees. So let's look at what did they get people to do the labeling of. The labeling of is, you know, they've got seven sort of key specific tasks here. First one being open Q&A. So this is just sort of general question and answering sort of stuff. Then they've got closed Q&A, so where someone's basically got a portion of text from Wikipedia or something and asking a question where the answer is in that. They've got to extract information from Wikipedia, summarize information from Wikipedia, brainstorming, classification, and creative writing. And I think each of these is kind of interesting. It would have been you know, you could always add to this, and you certainly could come along and make your own additions to this data set. One of the great things is they've put this data set up on the Hugging Face datasets API, so you can use it quite easily. And they have a number of examples in here of the different kinds of questions and answers that they've got in here to use. So if we look at the actual model, they've put up a number of these models. So they've got a 3 billion, a 7 billion, and a 12 billion version of this model. And it turns out, I'm going to start off by showing you the big one, but you can also use the smaller ones. And if you've got just access to free Colab, you'll want to use one of the smaller ones. So if we start off looking at the big one, we can see that, okay, here I'm using an A100 GPU and just basically bringing in the normal sort of stuff that I bring in for this kind of thing. The one interesting thing is that they've made their own kind of pipeline for Hugging Face. And it seems to me the main reason they've done this is to wrap their prompt into this sort of format that they're going to have. So you have the option when you bring the model in, let me just scroll down a bit. When you bring the model in, you can allow it to bring in its own code, which for security reasons can be an issue. I don't think it's an issue in this case. But here I'm showing you the version of where you can actually just put that file in here, because all this is, the main thing that this is doing is making this class called Instruction Text Generation Pipeline. And that's what we're going to be using in here. So you'll see when we look at the smaller ones, just quickly jumping around a little bit. In the smaller ones, I just say trust remote code equals true, and we just bring it straight in like that. So you don't have any of this other code going on there. But if you want to actually see what the code's doing, this is a good way of seeing, like, okay, what's going on with the pre-processing, what's going on with the post-processing as the text comes out. So we bring in the tokenizer and the actual model itself. So this is all coming from the model that they used for the pre-training was the Pythia 12 billion. So this is definitely an impressive model. The challenge, I guess, my one big issue with this model is that it's probably not trained for long enough in regards to the number of tokens. It's trained for about 300 billion tokens. If we look down here, we can see it's trained for 300 billion tokens, as opposed to the llama models, which are trained for 1 trillion tokens. So that's where a lot of that depth in the answers comes from. But anyway, so you're bringing that in, you're loading the actual model. You can see that the model itself is about 24 gigs. You will need a decent amount of RAM to be able to load this model. You can get away with a smaller GPU. You'll see that actually the amount of GPU RAM that it's using is not that much. The problem is actually getting it in and loading it onto your GPU in a Colab instance, for example. Once we've got it in there, we can basically, we're just using this pipeline that they've created, this instruction text generation pipeline. So that's got all their pre-processing in there. It's got a bunch of things like the temperature and various other parameters for the model set already for you. We can then come in and we can just start generating. So you can see here, if I ask it to, okay, what's the difference between llamas, alpacas, and koalas? I'm just giving you these prompts because we've looked at them so many times with other things. You can see that the responses that you're going to get back are like, and I would say they're good, but they're probably not as good as the koala model or something like that. But this is a huge trade-off. This is something you can use commercially and you don't have any problems with that. I write a short note to Sam Altman giving reasons to open source GPT-4. This is one of the prompts that we've used a lot. And you can see it actually writes a really nice note. It's quite articulate. It makes its points without being overly verbose. Another one that I've gone for is asking the capital of England, just because it's a very specific question. And it's interesting to see how long does it sort of play out. And here it gets it, London is capital city of England, and it just stops there. It doesn't go on too much. So that could be part of their fine tuning, or it could be due to, it could be influenced by the base model as well that we've got in there. One of the ones that I was impressed with was this writer's story about a koala playing pool and beating all the camelids. This basically went through, it talks about they were having a friendly game of pool. After a few shots, the koala knew he was the better player. It's a very coherent story going on here. So that's quite nice how it's got something like that. And the last one was testing it. So if you remember, with the koala model, when we asked it things like, do you like The Simpsons? And do you have a favorite character? Would just constantly say, oh, you know, I'm as an AI language model, I don't have any feelings or any preferences. Here we can see that we get a response back. I do indeed enjoy The Simpsons, just like all my fellow tenants. Okay, I know that Homer is a father of 13 children. Okay, it's definitely getting stuff wrong here. An alien in the show was a heavy smoker and drinker. Not sure about that. He also has a deep baritone voice. However, I'm not sophisticated AI like Caleb. Caleb knows a lot. So the quality of the output here is maybe not great compared to some of the other ones, but it's not sort of censoring what it's allowed to have a feeling about. So some people will probably like that more. Anyway, that's the 12 billion version. If you come in, you can also play with the 3 billion version. So the 3 billion version, you can just load up straight off. Here I am using the trust remote code part. So I'm not using the other way that I brought it in. You could use the other way. There's nothing to stop you from using either. You can see that this is using not a lot of GPU RAM at all. So people with older GPUs will definitely be able to use this model and have a play with it as it goes along. The other option that you've got in here too is the 7 billion parameter model. And the only difference here is I'm loading it in 8-bit. So we've got a much smaller checkpoint. So we can see that this is like, it's under 6 gig for the checkpoint. 7 billion one, I think it's actually 6.9 billion, but 7 billion one is looking at something around about a 14 gig checkpoint to load up. It also generates interesting answers, not always correct answers. You want to be aware of this, but it generates some really interesting sort of stuff out there. You can see here, this one, the smaller models are generating smaller notes to Sam Altman too, but the smaller model is still getting some of the other things right as well. Anyway, I'll put all three notebooks up. You can have a play with them, see what you think of Dolly 2 for yourself. I definitely think it's a good direction that they've gone in with the whole idea of making something that can be commercially used. Obviously, we don't have a model yet that's been trained to the degree of Llama, but I think it's just a matter of time before this happens. So I think, you know, Imad from Stability AI has already mentioned that they're training up some models with 3 trillion tokens. It's going to be really interesting to see how they go and when we actually get our hands on them. All right. As always, if you've got questions, please put them in the comments below. If you found the video useful, please click like and subscribe. I will see you in the next video. Bye for now.